Continuing our study of Matthew, we're in chapter 14, starting in verse 22. And again, we're in a period in the text where between chapters 40 and 20, it's primarily Jesus teaching the disciples. We've had the national rejection of the Messiah by the leadership from Jerusalem, there by the Pharisees in chapter 12, where they commit the unpardonable sin, which again was a national sin and the rejection of the Messiah, not an individual sin. After that, then Jesus begins to teach in parables, and we see that in chapter 13, because if the kingdom now is not coming, if the messianic kingdom is not coming to Israel because it's been rejected by that particular generation, then how will it come? And so Jesus begins to teach, it's going to be like a farmer who goes out and sows seeds. So again, it's going to be sown one seed at a time. It's going to be an individual thing. People individually are going to come into the kingdom. And we spent a couple of weeks going through what we call the kingdom parables. As we looked at last week, then Jesus gets news of the death of John the Baptist, the fact that Herod now, it basically thinks he's John the Baptist come back from the dead. He wants him dead as well. He's living in Herod's jurisdiction. And so he moves away, gets in a boat, goes to the other side of the lake, and he's going to now, in a sense, keep for most of his time. We're going to see him come back and forth to Capernaum a little bit, but he's going to stay away from Capernaum because he didn't come to die at the hands of Herod the Tetrarch in the area of northern Galilee. He came to die on a Roman cross in Jerusalem, and he would do that in his own time. In the process of teaching these guys, we get to this story of Jesus walking on the water, calming the storm, and so on and so forth. And you have to appreciate the fact that this is very Eastern. This is very Jewish in a well. If you're going to teach somebody, I mean, our teaching is like this. This is we're very Greek influenced in the Western world. This is how you teach. Somebody stands up, gives a lecture. But in the Eastern world, it's you take them out and do it with them, and you show them, you know. You don't. It's not a lecture kind of a thing, which makes it sometimes a challenge for missionaries that are out there teaching in Bible schools and stuff. People that are just not accustomed to standing, sitting, and taking notes and everything. So, with that as a background, you can appreciate the fact that Jesus now is going to teach them another important lesson. Last week we saw the feeding of the 5,000. Now he's going to tell them to head off to the other side. He'll join them later. And of course the storm comes up. But this is all part of the plan. Jesus is not shocked that there's a storm out in the middle of the ocean. This is all part of the training. He's going to scare the living daylights out of these guys. And you have to appreciate the fact that they are professional fishermen. And for all we can see, they figure they're all going to die in the middle of the lake. Make a real dramatic impact. How would you like to have a teacher like that? I want to make an impact, so I'm going to just scare you to death, you know, kind of a thing. Reminds me of one of the other pastors in Kailua that I knew for a number of years. He's on the mainland now, but he had a guy, a local guy in his church, and he was telling the story about how his nephew was giving his mom a hard time, and so he wanted to teach him a lesson. So he took him in his small boat, took him off Waimanalo, out past the reef, another like half a mile or so, and then give him a little talking to him about how it's important to obey his mother, do what she says, and so forth, because she's raising him on her own. And then he says, I'm going to help you remember this, and he threw him out overboard. Took the boat, he says, I'll meet you on the beach, and then he drove on in. It was a long swim in. I wasn't sure if he was going to make it, but he was really obedient after that. That's a very Eastern way of teaching something. Little bit of what's going on here with Jesus. Mark Twain writes his accounts of being in what he would refer to as the Holy Land. And one evening, there was a beautiful, he was staying in Tiberias, and there was a beautiful moon over the Sea of Galilee. And so he goes down to the edge where the fishermen were, and edge of the lake with his wife, and he wants to, you know, go out on the lake at night. and he tries to hire one of the boats. And Mark, have you ever seen those pictures? It's classic. He'd wear the white suits and the vest and the pocket watch and the little white hat and the whole thing. They probably thought he was a Texas millionaire or something because they told him they would do it, but they would charge him $250. That'd be like $2,000 today or whatever, right? And he says, now I know why Jesus walked on the water. But that's not why Jesus walked on the water. It's all part of training these guys. The read an interesting article by a guy named Lee Alcove, and he was talking about the fact growing up in the 50s, Parker Brothers came out with a game that was a Christian version of Monopoly. I never saw it or heard about it, but I'm sure it's available on eBay today. But nonetheless, he said you would, in the Christian version of Monopoly, instead of having a little Scotty dog or a little top hat, you had a little plastic apostle with a beard and a scroll under his arm and so forth that would move around the board. He said that you would make stops at the Mount of Olives, Bethsaida, Capernaum, the Stormy Sea, Nazareth, Bethany. And if you rolled the dice well, you made a triumphant entry into Jerusalem. He says, but you never got to the crucifixion or the resurrection. There were no demons, no angry Pharisees. You only made your way through the nice stories. It was a safe adventure, perfectly suited for a Christian family on a Sunday afternoon or a walk with Jesus. And then he says, it never occurred to me while leaning over the card table, jiggling the dice in my hand, that traveling with Jesus wasn't meant for plastic disciples who looked up verses in a little black Bible. If you're going to walk with Jesus as his disciple in this world, you may need to change your expectations. After all, Jesus said, take up your cross and follow me. Life is difficult at times, and we go through the storms of this life. We get sick, we get cancer, people die, we lose our jobs, we live in a real world. It's just not that easy. There's no bed of roses when you come to faith in Jesus Christ. And it has everything to do with this story. Tony Snow was, as you may not know, is a believer and went to be with the Lord just maybe a month or so ago. Former Fox News analyst and press secretary for President Bush from about early 2005. And when he was battling his cancer, somebody asked him what spiritual lessons he's learned from the battles. And he said, we want to live simple lives, predictable ease, smooth, even trails as far as the eye can see. But God likes to go off-road. where there's, you know, again, there's no marking, and it's pretty bumpy along the way. Let's take a look at this particular incident. Training session with the disciples, again, verse 22, and I'll read the whole incident here. Immediately, Jesus made the disciples get into the boat and go ahead of him to the other side while he dismissed the crowd. But after he had dismissed them, he went up on a mountainside by himself to pray. When evening came, he was there alone, but the boat was already a considerable distance from land, buffeted by the waves because the wind was against it. During the fourth watch of the night, Jesus went out to them walking on the lake. When the disciples saw him on the lake, they were terrified. It's a ghost, they said, and cried out in fear. But Jesus immediately said to them, take courage, it is I, don't be afraid. Lord, if it's you, Peter replied, tell me to come to you on the water. Come, he said. Then Peter got down out of the boat, walked on the water, and came towards Jesus. When he saw the wind, he was afraid, and beginning to sink, cried out, Lord, save me. Immediately Jesus reached out his hand and caught him. You have little faith, he said. Why did you doubt? And when they climbed into the boat, the wind died down. Then those who were in the boat worshipped him, saying, truly, you are the Son of God. When they crossed over, they landed at Gennesaret. And when the men of that place recognized Jesus, they sent word to all the surrounding country. People brought all their sick to him and begged him to let the sick just touch the edge of his cloak, and all who touched him were healed. Again, very simple principles here. The first one is that Jesus is the one that sends them into the storm. Jesus is the one that sends us into the storms. Jesus is the one that allows us to go through the difficulties of our life. I mentioned it last week, but John's gospel is the one that records the reason why he was in a hurry to usher those guys out of there. And that's after the feeding of 5,000, they wanted to make him king by force. And it just wasn't going to happen. So he gets his guys out of there, and then he takes care of the crowd, and he dismisses them. Again, the storm came because they were in the will of God, not out of the will of God. Got another slide for you. It just says, as we read our Bibles, we discover there are two kinds of storms. Storms of correction, when God disciplines us, and storms of perfection, when God helps us grow. Jonah was in a storm of correction, right? Jonah did not want to go and do what God was asking him to do. He was from a prophet from northern Israel. He was called to go up to the Assyrians, who were one of the most brutal people that's ever lived on the face of the planet before. And because he was from northern Israel, they more than likely had tortured and killed family members, if not just friends or people that he knew. And he knew that if he went up there, if they repented, they were not going to be judged, as was already predicted by another prophet. He wanted them to be judged. So in disobedience, you know the story, he ends up in a storm himself. God brings the storm in order to correct Jonah, to get him back on course again. But that's not what we have here. Although, so sometimes storms of life are come for that purpose, for correction. But here, these guys are totally in the will of God. God said to get in the boat, go to the other side. They got in the boat. They're going the other side. They're completely submitted to the Lord. They're in the center of God's will. And yet a storm comes. And in this case, and in this storm, it's for their own perfection, for them growing up. The point to see is that when you and I are going through a difficulty, God knows, he not only knows, he's allowed it. And in many cases, he specifically directed it because he either wants to correct us or to perfect us. And it is not a guessing game. Gee, I wonder which it is. If you're in disobedience to the Lord in radical sin, guess what? That's a correction. That, I mean, if you're rolling along, doing your best to walk with God and so forth, and those things come, God is allowing it, and he's allowing it for a purpose. He sends them into the storm. He sends us into storms as well. Secondly, Jesus prayed for them in the midst of the storm. Again, he dismisses the crowd. We see that in verse 23. And then we notice that Jesus prayed alone. And you have to think about this. If Matthew was out on the boat, how does Matthew write this and know that Jesus is alone praying? There's only one way he knows, and that's because Jesus told him. And there's only one reason Jesus would tell him is so he would write it down so we would know about it. Does that make sense? So that tells us a lot about the life of Jesus in that he does these things and tells them to write them down as examples to us. If you do not spend time alone with the Lord, you're missing out on a very large percentage of what your Christian experience and your Christian life is to be all about. It's good for us to be together, to pray together corporately. It's really great. I love one of my favorite times of the week is when we gather with the guys on Saturday mornings and pray. I love doing that. But that none of those things take the place of just your time alone with the Lord. And it gets hard to do, isn't it? I mean, I don't know about your life, but it just is the globe spinning faster or is it just me? It just seems like there's more of a hustle and more of a bustle and time is squeezed just more and more all the time. Jesus does this as an example. Look at Mark 1:35. Very early in the morning, while it was still dark, Jesus got up, left the house, and went off to a solitary place where he prayed. And we could find other examples. Jesus, on a regular basis, regardless of what he was doing with those guys and training them and so forth, he still made sure he had time to be alone in prayer. And of course, all of the early bird guys love this. See, that's when you're to do it, early in the morning when it's still dark out. That's the way Jesus did it. But for the rest of us, Psalm 55:17, evening, morning, noon, I cry out in distress and he hears my voice. It's not a timing issue here. It's setting aside some kind of time. whether it's at noon, whether it's in the evening, whether it's in the morning. Luke 5:15 says, again, yet news about him spread all the more so that crowds of people came to hear him and to be healed of their sickness. But Jesus often withdrew to lonely places and prayed. Again, we don't want to, Jesus put this in here for a reason that we would get it, that it's just so important that we spend a time alone with the Lord, communing with the Lord, in time just praying. Again, praying for ourselves, interceding for the things that God puts upon our hearts, reading his word, it's how we grow in our relationship with him. How many of you guys know that your marriages will not survive very long if you didn't take some time to talk with your wife alone? You're just not going to make it very, very long. It's important to have that flow of communication. If we're going to have a relationship with somebody, we've got to be talking to them, and not only in a crowd or with other people around, but so critical to our relationship. Secondly, Jesus prayed not only alone, but he prayed for them. We see in Mark's gospel, Mark 6:47, Luke and Mark also have parallel accounts of this event. When evening came, the boat was in the middle of the lake, and he was alone on the land. He saw the disciples straining at the oars because the wind was against them. Jesus knew exactly what was going on, and certainly he was interceding and praying for them. It should help us to know that when we're sitting in that emergency room awaiting the outcome of that test, that Jesus Christ is at the right hand of God praying and interceding for us. I mean, if he's allowing this thing to come and it's for his purpose, it should be some assurance to us to know that he is watching and he is praying for us. I used to get letters from my grandmothers when they were both before they went to be with the Lord, and one of them would always sign at the end, "I'm praying for you, but Jesus is praying more." It's a good line. It's nice to have a couple of grandmothers praying for you. I don't want to discount that, but the point was, it's so much more important to realize that Christ is praying for us. Romans 8:34, Christ Jesus, who died, more than that, who was raised to life, is at the right hand of God and is also interceding for us, as Paul. The writer of Hebrews, I love this verse, 7:25, therefore he is able to save completely those who come to God through him, because he always lives to intercede for them. Our salvation is a done deal. He is able to save completely, the writer says, because Christ always lives to intercede for us. So again, it's Jesus that sends them into the storm. He's spending time alone with the Lord, but certainly part of what he's doing there is interceding, and that should be a help to us to know that in the midst of those times, to remember that Christ is praying for us. Three, Jesus comes to them in the midst of the storm. We see that in verses 25 and 27. Jesus came to them on the water. And you can imagine these guys, verse 24, the boat was already a considerable distance from land. That means it's halfway out in the middle. And the idea from where they were, they would need to row against the wind to a certain point so then they could put their sails up and then make it into Capernaum. They just can't make a straight shot over there. They've got to get out in the middle or beyond so they can kind of tack back the other way. They're out in the middle and they just can't make it. They're not going anywhere. And we can tell from some of the other passages, even though this is a pretty good sized boat, I think we showed a slide of it early on in our study of a 2/3 scale model of it. It's pretty good size. It's not like a little rowboat or anything. And these guys thought that they were going down. It's interesting there in verse 24, the word buffeted is a word in the Greek that's used very often to describe other events of difficulty in our lives. Sometimes we even use that phrase, it's not a buffet, it's I've been buffeted. I'm being pushed or driven against, it seems like. It certainly can be physical in this case, but certainly it can be spiritual very often. And one of the things that had to be going through Peter and the boys' minds at this point is, Jesus has absolutely abandoned us. I mean, he's just with us. He shoves us out here. He's up on the mountainside somewhere praying, and here we are. We're all ready to die out here. And certainly we could look back and go, Well, why in the world would they think that? I mean, Jesus has handpicked these guys. He's training them. He's going to send them out to preach the gospel. Certainly they knew they weren't going to die here. This was all just a test. No, they didn't. Is that what you think? I mean, you know, when somebody runs in the side of your car and you're on your way to the hospital and the ambulance, praise the Lord, this is just a test. God's using it in my life. Glory to God. There's probably someone here. We don't often, you know, actually, you know, you've read story about other people that react that way, right? But that does, I've read those stories too. Sometimes I even get it a little glimpse once in a while in the middle. But that's the point here. These guys didn't at all. They're just kind of like the rest of us. And as far as they know, based on their circumstances and what was happening, Jesus Christ had totally abandoned them at this point. I would imagine they're even a little ticked off. At this point, because they back in chapter 8, they saw him. He's sleeping in the boat. Big storm comes up, and he gets up and speaks the word, "Peace be still," and it's all gone. So what's happening now? Where's Jesus when we really need him? Kind of a thing. If they're like me, I mean, I've just been some of these situations just flat out mad, angry, and tell the Lord about it. I got a feeling they may have been as well. There was nobody in that boat apparently saying, hey, hold on here. Just kind of hang in there. Keep bailing that water. We're going to make it anytime. Jesus is going to come walking across that water. I mean, man, he's the Son of God. He can do whatever. We'll just be looking for him. Hey, I think I see him now in the distance. No, nobody's saying that. Nobody's looking to the Lord. Nobody in this boat is saying, I don't care how bad it is. We're just going to trust the Lord. It would have been good. If somebody has said something, and it is good in the midst of those times when somebody does say something of some encouragement, something to get our eyes back on the Lord. But it's just not happening. There are times when life is so distressing, we forget to even look for Jesus, that he might be in the midst of that situation, causing it, praying for us. And if we're looking, he'll meet us in the midst of that. Paul has got in a few of those situations. 2 Corinthians 1:8, he says, "We do not want you to be uninformed, brothers, about the hardships we suffered in the province of Asia. We were under great pressure, far beyond our ability to endure. So we despaired even of life. Indeed, in our hearts we felt the sentence of death. But this happened that we might not rely upon ourselves, but on God, who raises the dead." Why did it happen? That they might not rely upon themselves. Big lesson. big lesson. Our submission to the Lord, our trust in him, that we might not rely upon ourselves. What did these guys do for a living? Professional fishermen. Do they have every reason in the world to rely upon themselves in their boat in the middle of the Sea of Galilee, where they fished every day for a living? Just a little bit of a reason. There's a reason why Jesus picks this scenario. Why did Jesus walk on the water? I like what Warren Wiersbe says. To show his disciples that the very thing they feared, the sea, was only a staircase for him to come to them. The very thing, what is it that you fear in the midst of that trial, in the midst of the suffering? It could be that very thing that Jesus will come to you in a sense on or through to reveal himself in a way that, frankly, just may not be another way for us to really grasp it or to understand it, because we're not desperate enough to really lose ourselves and come to the end to really, really trust him. It's like one guy said, "Well, I'm just barely hanging on. You don't know what I'm going through. You're just barely hanging on? Let go." Let go. It's God that's holding you anyway, you know. So just let go. Trust the Lord. The other thing we see, secondly, is that Jesus came to them and they did not recognize him. And why they didn't recognize him, as I've kind of already mentioned, is they weren't looking for him. I mean, they were just weren't, there was nobody going, "He'll be here any minute. We got our eye out. You know, we'll see him," and so forth. It's your. It's amazing when you go to the canoe regattas and how far out, you know, the canoes can be. But if you know where to look, you can see that flash of the paddle, you know, as it pops up way, way out there, way before you can ever see them coming. But you got to be looking. If you're not looking, you would never see them coming in the canoe. It's, you know, these guys were not looking for Jesus. And that's why when he does get there, they're terrified. And again, these are guys that were asked to sail to the other side. But the lesson they needed to learn was to trust him, even though he wasn't present. Because he's always with them, right? I mean, it's a lot easier for them to trust him when Jesus is, can I trust Jesus? Yeah, he's the guy right there, right? But I mean, he's not with them. That's the lesson. Can they trust him even when he's not there? That's why this is such a big issue for us. Can we, now is Jesus with us all the time? Absolutely. But he's not some guy in a robe and sandals that we can point to. Can we trust him and look for his presence even in the midst of this kind of storm? We notice also he came to them with encouragement. He tells them to take courage. And again, the encouragement is supposed to come before because of his presence. Psalm 27:14 says to wait for the Lord, be strong and take heart and wait for the Lord. That word wait is not a time issue. It's an issue that indicates we're trusting the Lord. That's why sometimes NIV will translate it hope. Those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. New King James would be wait. Waiting on the Lord is the indicator that I'm hoping, I'm trusting. Trust in the Lord. Be strong and take heart. I love Isaiah 41:10. Do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you by my righteous right hand. That's a lot of power, God's righteous right hand. But so easy to fear in these situations when it really we want to learn to trust him. Now, again, listen to what Jesus says. Very much the same thing right before he would go to the cross in John 16:33. I've told you these things so that in me you may have peace. In this world you will have trouble, but take heart, I've overcome the world. We will have trouble in this life. As long as we're living in this fallen world, we've got our flesh to deal with and so forth, we're going to have trouble. But Jesus says, take heart because I've overcome the world. And the whole issue is that if we can trust him, then we can have a peace even in the midst of the storm. Look at Mark 6:49. It says, they cried out because they all saw him and were terrified. Immediately he spoke to them and said, take courage, it is I, don't be afraid. I just appreciate the fact that when at the apex of their fear, when he does show up, they don't know it's him because they're not looking for him. And it says they're terrified. It says then Jesus like counted to 10. 1, 2, 3. And let them sweat it out a little bit and then identify. No, it says immediately he identifies himself and says, it's I. Take courage. It's all right. And that leads us to the fourth thing. So he sends them in the storm, but he's interceding for them. He comes to them in the midst of the storm. And then fourth, Jesus allows Peter to personally test his faith in the midst of the storm. But in thinking about this, I think this is the whole issue. It's easy to get, and we love to get on Peter's case, right? Because he's like us, or he's like me. I don't know if you make that claim as well. But I appreciate Peter because he blows it so often. And we see God's grace extended him time and time again. And I find that to be encouraging. But at the same time, in this situation, he's the only guy that really does the right thing. In the midst of the storm that God sends us into, in this sense, for our perfection, not our correction, but in the midst of our growing us up, as he's interceding for us, as they're crying out in desperation, he comes to them, he identifies himself immediately, and when Peter sees him, he says, that's where I want to be, in the presence of Jesus. You know, some week it's easy to get on Peter's case and go, oh, that bug, he's going to get out of the boat. You know, he's like trying to show up the other guys. I don't think that's it. I think it's like the storm's still going on. It hasn't stopped yet. In the midst of this storm, when Jesus finally does come, that should be where I should be looking for him. And when I see him, and how do I see him? Maybe it's through just the scripture, an encouragement from somebody. I get that that peace of God that's coming to me, that is available to me, that I can look to, I can commune with, I can get alone and I can pray, I can see the Lord, and I can have what He wants me to have and grow through and still be in the storm, and still be in the midst of the storm. Jesus, I mean, Peter is going to him and is going to stand there with him in the midst of the storm. Peter doesn't say, make it all real. Hey, how about some glassy conditions? And then I'll come walking to you on the water. See, he doesn't do that. He just says, in the middle of the storm, can I come and be with you? And I think that's the right response here. Charles Spurgeon says that we can do anything if we have divine authorization and courage enough to take the Lord at His word. So Peter's the guy that responds by faith. Secondly, Peter responded in submission. One translation it would said, bid me to come. It's a Greek word. It means you're the king. I'm asking the king for permission. So what he's really saying here is certainly an issue of faith, but it's also one of submission as well. And the Lord will come to us. James 4:8 says, come near to God and He will come near to you. He's not the guy that has moved in the midst of the storm. It's usually us in terms of our attitude and viewpoint and so forth. Thirdly, Peter responded to the circumstances around him. And as we know the story, he does walk on water towards Jesus. Then he sees the wind. He begins to be afraid. He begins to sink. He cries out. And then notice again, the Lord reaches out. And again, in the Greek text, we know that it's Jesus that's hanging on to him. It's not Peter that's hanging on to the Lord. I don't know that if he was blah, blah, blah at that point, but it's the Lord. It's very indicates it's the Lord that's hanging on to him. That's important for us to see as well. Then he says to Peter, why did you have a little faith and why did you doubt? And I think this is, I've got this underlined in yellow. Jesus saves him even in the midst of his doubts. Do you ever doubt? In the middle of suffering, in the middle of trials, in the middle of difficulties, you get angry with God, you begin to doubt, His character. Does He really love you? Does He really care? He'll come and save you anyway. You know, sometimes we make an issue out of that. Probably one of the great spokesmen for Christianity and a couple of generations ago was C.S. Lewis, a brilliant man, Oxford scholar, and love to read his books and quote from him. But I don't know if you know, but the whole story at the death of his wife, man, he went through a time of a tremendous doubt. I mean, he doubted everything. He doubted the gospel, whether Jesus loved. He just went through. He was mourning for his wife. It was just a horrific thing. It was. I don't know if you know the story. She was an admirer. She's from America. She was much younger. She moved to England with her sons. And just met him. She was a writer herself, and they developed a friendship and so forth. She was going to have to move back to the United States because her visa was expiring. They would not renew it and everything. And so he married her so she could become a British citizen and stay. But they were just totally platonic. It was just totally friends. And then she developed cancer. And so all of a sudden, everything changed. And he's with her through the whole process and the chemotherapy and everything. And then she goes into remission. And she's like healthy and feeling great. And in the process, they fell in love of going through that trial and that difficulty. And then they had this wonderful relationship that lasted until the cancer came back. And then he lost his wife. And this is a very brilliant guy that can give you all the intellectual reasons for faith in God and Christ and the issues that sometimes can plague us. And yet, C.S. Lewis went through a time of real doubting. But it was just for a time. But the Lord is right there. The Lord will rescue us even in the midst of that. In a sense, we're in the storm. We might understand God's allowed it. We might understand that God is interceding for us. We might understand that He might show up somehow in the midst of this. And even if we're looking for Him, but even in the midst of that, and we're trying to reach out to Him, but the circumstances are so bad that we're just having our doubts and our fears and our anger. And Jesus says, that's all right. I'll grab you and I'll pull you out of this anyway. That's the grace of God. And it's good to know that he'll do that. John 6:39 says, and this is the will of him who sent me, obviously Jesus speaking, that I shall lose none of all them he has given me, but raise them up in the last day. For my Father's will is that everyone who looks to the Son and believes in him shall have eternal life, and I will raise them up the last day. How many is he going to lose? None. Does it depend on whether you ever doubt or not? It has nothing to do with it. It has nothing to do with it. If you've come to faith in Jesus Christ, you're his. You're his child. If my kids, my son or daughter, ever doubted whether I was really their father or not, would I still care any less or love them? Absolutely. Absolutely. It has nothing to do with it. It has nothing to do with how much God loves you, whether he died for you or not. Your reaction, he sends you into the storm for your perfection. You don't do well. You kind of fall apart, actually. Actually, you're really ticked off at God. Can't believe he put you through that. And if he really cared for you, he don't ever let this happen. Anybody relating here? You know what? He loves you anyway. He's going to save you out of the midst of it anyway. He's just going to reach down and grab you and pull you up out of the whole thing. I think that's what this whole story is about. Jesus is trying to teach them, but obviously he gives us more details that Matthew would write down and in the other gospel accounts, because this is really for all of us. We can thank the Lord that they all went through it. We didn't have to get out in the boat and almost drown to get the message here. But then they climb into the boat. We might say that Jesus caught them and then taught them. Later, Peter would write this in 1 Peter 3:12. For the eyes of the Lord are on the righteous, and his ears are attentive to their prayer. He might have been thinking about this time, being out there, and he's quoting the Old Testament. Again, Peter failed because he took his eyes off of the Lord, but God saves him even in the midst of his failure. But I want to say that he's the guy that got out the boat and went in the middle of the storm to be with Jesus. And I think that was actually the appropriate response. And then we notice also, lastly, that Peter's response became a blessing to others. Or we could say Peter's failure actually became a blessing to others. Because at that point, he saves Peter. They get in the boat. The ocean is calm at that point. Now back in Matthew 8, when Jesus was sleeping in the boat and then gets up and calms the storm, they said, what manner of man is this? That's not their response this time. This time they say, truly, you are the Son of God. You're God. That's what they're saying. I mean, they're in their vernacular. And they kind of begin to get it, who it is that's really teaching them, who that's really discipling them. Peter's failure became a blessing to them. And certainly, our failures can too. We want to be the very best witness we can for Jesus Christ. I'm not saying go out and blow it on purpose here or anything. Or not have faith and trust the Lord in the midst of the storms of your life. But I do believe even if God set the whole thing up and he did it for a reason, he did it for our growth, even when we don't come out too good on the other side and it becomes very obvious to everyone that the only way we made it through was by God pulling us out and by his grace, that's not such a bad thing either. Wow, I thought you were a really strong Christian. You're a wimp, boy, but God is powerful. How can I know him? That's not such a bad thing. I remember when I was coaching Pony League Baseball in Waimanalo for a number of years, and of course I'm doing my best to be a good witness for God. They all know that I'm a pastor and everything, and it wasn't always easy. And I've told you my umpire stories before, but I had this one kid that was like a prima donna, and he was, I could tell the way his mom and the boyfriend treated him and everything. And he was kind of a bully and would pick on the other kids, which would just drive me crazy. And I had already lectured him. I'd made him, miss batting practice. I'd made him run laps. I'd make him do push-ups. And finally, he did something where he whacked one of the other kids. And I don't know if I should repeat what I said, but anyway, I grabbed him by the shirt and lifted him up off the ground. and said a few kind words to him, something to the effect, if he did that again, he would no longer have his head, it wouldn't be connected, and put him back down on the ground. And the team mom, fortunately that was not her kid, the team mom that was there, "Oh wow, Pastor Tim, wow, I've never seen you lose it like that before." And she's just going on and on. I go, "Yeah, sorry, I'm really sorry. No, no, it's kind of cool, actually, you know, because, you know, I was kind of afraid to be around you, you know." And she went on and on. What a blessing it was to her that I totally, totally lost it. It just kind of changed the whole relationship. All of a sudden, people could relate a little more. And even in our failures, God can use them. If we look at this, is this a failure of Peter's? Jesus says, "Why did you have little faith? Why did you doubt?" He shouldn't have. He should have just kept his eyes on the Lord. But that's not to say that it didn't turn out to be a tremendous blessing. I don't know how Peter was feeling about getting back in the boat, wringing out his clothes and stuff. Hey, but everybody else, it was a total blessing. Truly, you are the Son of God. Why did you have such little faith? Now, Mark's gospel gives us an interesting insight. Mark chapter 6, verse 51. "Then he climbed into the boat with them, and the wind died down. They were completely amazed, for they had not understood about the loaves, the feeding of the 5,000. Their hearts were hardened." So they needed to learn a lesson here. Why does Jesus send them into this thing? Well, he's healed all these people. He's doing this radical miracle. He even makes them pick up the 12 baskets. And by the way, the baskets were big enough that you could climb in. I don't know if I mentioned that last week. They were not like little baskets. It was a lot that was left over that these guys had to carry on their backs probably for a day or so. Maybe they would get it then, but they didn't because their hearts were hardened. They're missing out on the whole thing. What hardens your heart? Unbelief. I mean, they couldn't get their mind around that they needed to trust Jesus and place their faith in him, even though they're walking with him every day, even though they're seeing the miracles every day. And God sends them out to try to teach them in a very radical manner. Lastly, fifth, Jesus came through the storms to meet the needs of many. They cross over, verse 34, 35. They land at Gennesaret. They recognize Jesus. They send word out through the surrounding country. They bring the sick. And everybody that comes up and even touches the edge of his cloak is healed. Do you think that they knew the storm he went through to get to them? I don't think they knew. I don't think they even considered it. I think they just saw him and they had needs and they wanted those needs met. And sometimes we can be like that as well. We know Jesus. We know what he can do. We've got needs. We want them to be met. And it's easy to forget about the storms of the cross that it took to get him to us to start with. And it's good to keep that in mind. What Jesus was willing to go through so that he could once again show tremendous compassion upon these people. I'll date myself here a little bit, but Dallas Holman Praise was kind of a popular Christian worship band in the 80s, David, was that about right? 80s, maybe those guys are still around. Yeah, we used to hear their music once in a while on Key Light. But his wife, Linda, was diagnosed with cancer, had the surgery, had the chemo. This is several years ago. But he said this in an interview about that, going through that experience with his wife. He says, "Sometimes in our valley and in our sorrow, we believe if we just knew what God was doing, that would settle it. I'm not sure that would make any difference. Faith is when you don't know, when it doesn't make sense, when you can't understand, but you trust God." These guys, they didn't really understand what was going on. The issue was just whether they would trust the Lord or not, and God's using it to try to grow them up. Again, a very simple story, but really, I think, profound if we can kind of hang on to even some elements of this in the midst of the storms of life ourselves. Amen.
Mountain Maker. Mountain Maker. Ocean Tamer. Glimpses of you burning my eyes. worship of heaven fills up the sky. You made it all, said let there be, and there was. All that we see, the sound of your voice, works of your hand, you do all things well. You do all things well. You do all things well. Stop creator. Wind breather. Strokes of your beauty runs through the clouds. Light from the heavens touching the ground. You made it all, said that there be, and there was. All that we see, the sound of your voice, works of your hands. You do all things well. You do all things well. You do all things well. Imagination runs wild, breathes the breath of life across the fields, across the miles. You made it all, said let there be, and there was. All that we see, the sound of your voice, the works of your hands. You do all things well. You do all things well. You do all things well. Your love, your love is extravagant. Your friendship, it is intimate. Feel like the movement in the rhythm of your grace, your friendship is intoxicated in the secret place. Your love is extravagant. Your friendship, it is intimate. Feel like a movement, rhythm of your grace, your fragrance is intoxicated in the secret place. Your love is extravagant. Spread wide in the arms of pride. Love because of sin. No greater love have I ever known. Consider me a friend, captured my heart again. Your love, your love is extravagant. Friendship, it is intimate. Feel like moving in the rhythm of your grace. Your faith is intoxicated in the secret place. Your love is extravagant. Spread wide in the arms of Christ. Love covers sin. No greater love have I ever known. Consider me a friend. You captured my heart again.
We pray that we might lay aside all those things that hinder us. That we might have a clean slate before you, Lord, and our eyes tightly focused on you. Continue to be with us, Lord, through this song. Let's all stand.
Praise Adonai.
Who is like him, Lion and the Lamb, seated on the throne? Mountains bow down, every ocean roars to the Lord of hosts. Praise Adonai, from the rising of the sun to the end of every day. Praise Adonai, all the nations of the earth, all the angels and the saints sing praise. Who is like him? Who is like him, the Lion and the Lamb, seated on the throne? Mountains bow down, every ocean roars to the Lord of hosts. Praise Adonai, from the rising of the sun to the end of every day. Praise Adonai, all the nations of the earth, the angels and the saints sing praise. Who is like him? Who is like him? The Lion and the Lamb, seated on the throne. Mountains bow down, every ocean roar to the Lord of hosts. Praise Adonai, from the rising of the sun to the end of every day. Praise Adonai, all the angels and the saints,
all the angels and the saints sing
praise Adonai, from the rising of the sun to the end of every day. Praise Adonai, all the nations of the earth, all the angels and the saints sing praise. We praise you, O God, Adonai, O Lord and Savior.